Marjorie Sewell Cautley is a really important landscape architect in the early 20th century, and important for the work that she did and for the role that she played as a woman landscape architect, deeply invested in landscape architecture as a public service, who was born in 1891, died in 1946. She is the landscape architect for Radburn, New Jersey, Sunnyside, Hillside, and Phipps Apartments, which are projects that are all known as being designed by a group of people, a team of people led by Clarence Stein and Henry Wright. Particularly Radburn is probably one of the most important garden city models built in the United States that served as a model for other projects around the country and eventually actually around the world. Many of the landscape architects who were women who came from relatively privileged backgrounds, not necessarily wealthy, but privileged backgrounds. Cautley came from a working class family, a family of civil servants, and she comes into landscape architecture very much with the values and ethics of that background. And so she sees landscape architecture not merely as a profession or a practice of making beautiful landscapes, but as a way of truly and with incredible intention to improve the lives of everyday families. And furthermore, she sees landscape as a way to benefit and improve the lives of women and particularly mothers. And so her designs for these garden city models are in large part her way of addressing the needs of women and mothers and families and children. And so she's really paying attention to things like, what can you see out the kitchen window, but how do I also make a little privacy for the family when they hang out their laundry? Or when they do want a private conversation in their garden. So she plays with how to shape a landscape so that it provides these varying needs of the family, of children, but I think particularly of women and mothers. And that's something that I think is incredibly strong in all of her projects. You see it come up again and again, this very close attention to how does the family really live and how do mothers and children and what kind of spaces do they need? She is part of, right, the late progressive era, and landscape architecture emerges as the progressive era is a strong force. So in many ways, landscape architecture as a whole had that social agenda in the early 20th century. She wrote articles called things like Landscapes for the Unemployed and advocated for unemployed people to be hired to build parks and to learn the trade of what we would call landscape and gardening today. And I think there's actually a very powerful link between her work and her writing and her practice. And that again has to do with her sense of her work, her job, her career as a civil servant, that landscape architecture is a public servant. And what her book does is explain color theory, which is an artistic concept, to a set, what in her view was a person who wanted to understand. It's in simple, direct language. It actually comes, the book comes with this whole cutout piece where you can compare colors and understand the color theory. So there are all of these concerns of the very mundane part of somebody's life, doing laundry or tending to the vegetable garden or overseeing the children, but also in an equally accessible language, how to understand composition in the landscape, how to understand color. And it's interesting because that book is used by a lot of programs for about a decade as a real reference book as they're teaching landscape architects. But it's also used by garden clubs and others to learn. So first of all, I think her legacy is in this articulation of landscape architecture as a public service, as a practice that is intended for the public, and in her own modeling, why it matters that there are landscape architects who have the lived experience of the people with whom they are working, the communities with whom they are working. And she models that and she does that. And we see the project she did with that attitude as the projects that are National Historic Landmarks today, Radburn, Roosevelt Common. These are landscapes that she designed with and for the very communities that were going to use them. And she could do it so well because she walked in similar shoes. But her other legacy is in the numbers of women that she hired and trained. Ellis Irees works in her office, as do a number of other women at the time. And one of the things a number of them will talk about is there came a time where Cautley would be like, okay, it's time for you to get out there and do your own thing. So I think her other legacy is really pushing and mentoring other designers to get out there and also do work that matters in the public realm and that truly improves people's lives, as she imagined places like Radburn did and Phipps Apartments did and Hillside and Oakcroft and Roosevelt Commons, that these are all important places for the ways that they shape healthier, better communities. And that was important to her.